Slip into your pyjams now on BBC Two for maximum effect. We want you to pretend it's Saturday morning and spend the next couple of hours in front of the telly. Childhood memories by the bucket load and some strong language in It Started with Swap Shop.
Welcome to Swap Shop. Wow, I haven't said that for 30 years. Yes, the Swappy, as Billy Connolly christened it, is for one night only open for business again. In 1976, Swap Shop instantly attracted millions of viewers of all ages and undoubtedly set the theme for the next 30 years of Saturday morning children's TV. Tonight, I'm joined by all the stars from these great shows. We've got my old desk, we've got the old clock, we've got the old top 10 board. In fact, it's been so long, even I appear to be back in fashion. The one thing we didn't have on Swap Shop 30 years ago was a studio audience. Yeah! All right, calm yourselves. Calm yourselves, please. Well, that's pretty good for a generation raised on space dust, curly whirlies and smash. Let's take a trip back in time.
Minutes.
It's too frightening.
Well done.
Sweet bye bye.
Take another 30 years if you go on like that. It all started right here in this studio, TC3 at the Television Centre in London. Through 30 incredible years, whether you were a kid with a crush or a student with a hangover, Saturday morning children's TV always seemed to have the perfect tonic. So tonight, Swap Shop will also be remembering and celebrating some of your other Saturday morning favourites, including Saturday Superstore. You won't be laughing in a minute. Mike Reed has still got that guitar and he's not afraid to use it. Going live! The only show to teach the nation how to swing its pants and live and kicking. So we'll have plenty of special guests, swaps, phone calls, surprises, in fact, all of the ingredients which have made Saturday mornings so special. And could I please ask you, at the beginning, when you see the old clips, get the laugh about my hairdos out of the way. We don't need to laugh at every clip. Swap Shop wouldn't be the same without the rest of the team. So would you please welcome John Craven?
Fantastic, isn't it?
It feels like the real thing.
The years are just rolling away.
Yeah. What's your memory? What's the overriding memory?
Well, I think the very first Swap Shop, the first moments of it, this was supposed to be the very first phone-in TV show. And the phones didn't ring, did they?
No, they didn't. It's really important, because you'll enjoy this show even more, just to remember, no faxes, no emails, no mobile phones, nothing. It was history to be able to telephone a television show, and no one called.
Nobody rang for ages, did they?
It's true.
Then, by about 11 o'clock, the Shepherd's Bush telephone exchange just about exploded with all the calls.
They couldn't deal with the calls that came. It was something like 1.25 million calls came in a couple of minutes. I mean, it was just incredible.
And we knew we got hit then, didn't we?
We did. We did indeed.
And tonight, I'm going to help you jog your memory with some special Swap Shop news bulletins, which will whisk you back to the days when you were a kid sitting in front of the telly in your pyjamas on a Saturday morning. Yeah. And I promise you, Noel, none of my old jokes, like the one about...
yes, fine. Yeah. 1 year into Swap Shop, the team was joined by a young lady who was set to become the big sister to thousands of kids across the country. But to us, she will always be our Maggie. Ladies and gentlemen, Maggie Philbin.
Nice to do this while we can all make it down the stairs, isn't
yes.
it?
Yes, because you've got one of those walk-in baths now, haven't you? Well, John asked for a stair lift down there. You know? So what are you going to be doing?
Well, you know, when I think back over my time on Saturday mornings, the things that I'd forgotten, apart from your and John's sort of comprehensive range of sweaters, was the way that the show was a real barometer for the key trends of the time, not only for fashion, but for the toys that you had to have, the fads and crazes that absolutely swept the playground. So tonight, that's what I'm going to be celebrating, reminding you of things you probably much rather forget. And all I'm going to say, Noel, is leg warmers, Lycra, and puffball skirts. You look fabulous in all of them.
Thank you. It's going to have a little feisty edge to it, I think. This. Well, our team wouldn't be complete without a certain other person who you might have noticed is missing. Yeah, I'm sorry. I'm sorry, Posh Paws. He's done really well for himself. He was the technical advisor on Jurassic Park 1, 2 and 3. And it's good to have you with us. Glorious disconnect between the mouth movement and the noise you hear. Anyway, work on it. As I was saying, hard as we tried to get him into the studio, true friends of Swap Shop will remember every week without fail, you would have heard me cry, "Where are you, Keith?"
I can hardly believe it, well, hey, yeah, very good evening to you. Welcome live to a Swap of Armour. And if you're coming down tonight, I can tell you the weather is for all fun. I told you that wouldn't work. It didn't work 30 years ago. I don't believe it. A very, very... Oh, my gosh. A very good evening to you all. Oh, what? Yeah, this used to be my home, TC3. We used to come out and chat to the stars. The BBC. Yes, built in 1960 it was. Home to some great shows like Jeggers Plays Pop. I was known for me facts on the show. Some fascinating facts for you. We had 6,000 phone calls, 450 guests, and wait for it, 4,004 million letters of complaint. No, I'm joking. Great letters. Good evening. Nice to see you. Thank you. Thank you. Lovely. Now, what?
No, they promised me the rest of the gig, mate.
Oh, God, God. Get out of there.
Nice to be here. All right. Good. Hello to you.
It's going to take forever to get that snow off you.
I know, I'm covered in it, aren't I? Gee whiz. What great days. Can I just thank all the kids out there who were part of the show and gave me some wonderful things. Head lice. Nicked. And one of you out there nicked my gold wristband. I want it back.
Hopefully this lot are going to be friendlier.
Yeah, look at them.
You're going to do a swapper arm.
I'm going to be swapping with that lot out there.
Celebrity guests ringing and also appearing here in the studio. We've got a lot of your Saturday morning favourites as well. Oh, I was just noticing here the swap board. Little Noel offers a blue box, wants to beat the evil banker. Jose offers £500 million, wants to hold on to the premiership. Jamie is offering healthy school dinners, wants never to see a turkey Twizzler. And, oh, yes, Gordon Brown offers number 11, wants number 10. Anyway, keep the swaps coming in. We've got, I mean it, all your Saturday morning favourites, all the big names, the stars are with us on this special show. Philip Schofield, Sarah Green, Mike Reed, Emma Forbes, Andy Peters, plus fans of the show, Lenny Henry, Chris Moyles, and many, many more. In fact, I've got a real Swap Shop fan on the line now, and here's a subtle clue. Hello, banker. Not now. Here's the subtle clue.
Would you please welcome Dame Edna Everidge?
Edna, good morning.
Good morning to you, and good morning to all my lovely little Swap Shop viewers, wherever you are.
Hopefully, all the way from Byron Bay in Australia, Dame Edna.
Hello, Noel. Hello, Lucy.
Hello, Dame Edna. How are you?
Darling, I've stayed up all night to talk to you.
What memories?
Luckily, I had some company, little Robbie Williams.
What memories do you have, Dame Edna, of that marvellous period?
I'm a lucky megastar, Noel, because my memory is perfect, even if my voice is a little husky. And I have such happy memories of you. As a young man, you had hair. And that lovely smile of yours, and it's a miracle that that show is still running. I didn't give it more than a fortnight when I first saw it. So congratulations, Noel.
Thank you. Didn't you, on Swap Shop, swap a stuffed kangaroo and a stuffed koala?
It broke my heart stuffing those animals. I'm afraid anything.
What do you have on offer tonight, Dame Edna?
Now, I'm going to offer something special, and I'm going to Melbourne to do my new show, which later I'll bring to London, though the cast might have changed. And I'm doing it in Melbourne till the end of January, and I'm offering two of the best seats in the theatre to anyone who wants to swap, and all they have to do is pay their airfares to Australia. But if they've got any friends in Melbourne or in Australia, the seats are theirs. Right. Now, these are worth a fortune.
And is there anything you're particularly looking for? Because Keith Chegwin is in our audience here, ready to get you anything you want.
Within reason.
I've got it. I'm so lucky. I want a record of a lovely song called I Want to Be a Winner.
No.
Yeah. No.
Remember that?
Okay. You're not going to believe this. There is a guy here, but he was here for another reason. This is Al what?
Taylor. It's Taylor. Al Taylor.
Yeah.
It can only be described as the pinnacle of the British music industry. And with you and him and that lady there.
Dame Edna, the record, are you happy with it?
I love it.
Great, you've got the tickets, she's got the record, yes!
Thank you. Thank you and goodbye, Dame Edna.
Happy New Year, lots of love to you all. Bye.
Thank you. Thank you very much. See why the slots are always the most memorable part of the show, but there were lots more reasons why we all love Swap Shop.
And now on BBC One, something to put a smile on your face. It's time for Swap Shop.
For the first time ever, an entire Saturday morning was given over to children's TV.
Good morning, welcome to Swap Shop.
Oh, morning!
We've got so much to get through. We've got a really packed programme today. A programme that's
morning.
Packed with...
Morning!
Well, no, it was him.
We had swaps.
Now, these are some little swap shop starlings.
Puppets. Oh, still got the indigestion. Anyway, nice to see you back, Posh Boys.
Letters. Star guests.
Noel Edmonds.
Yes.
Oh, I've always wanted to meet you.
Hello, hello, line five.
Hello?
Hello?
And the occasional technical hitch.
Ow! Don't let me interrupt.
I think we've actually got a few slight problems there, have we now?
Hello, Keith.
Turn around, Volv. The one with the light on.
Keith Swaparama toured the country.
This morning I'm in a very saucy place. Any ideas?
Could you please tell me if it's true that John Craven wears a hairpiece? As I've heard... as I've heard many rumours about it. Oh.
While we had fun in London.
It's our overacting spot.
Swappers came to the studio.
How did this come about? Are you a phenomenal reader?
Well, yes, I do read a lot.
So you'd like any bookmark, but particularly if they come from abroad? Yeah. You'd be interested in that?
Well, I've got four Chinese bookmarks to swap.
Did you say they were on cardboard or leather?
Card.
OK, I'll think about it. Thank you very much.
And the latest trends were road testing.
With this letter, I enclose some space dust. You put it in your mouth and then you wait. Right, there we go. Now, before you do anything, could we have a bit of boom? If we could get the boom in just about as near as possible. Lovely. Excellent. Don't actually do anything with it, you just let us have a listen. Open your mouth.
First of all, I've got to say... I've got to publicly apologise for that. That was so bossy. John, I'm so sorry about that. But stick that in your mouth, will you? we don't have booms as such these days, so we've got a man-made right. boom here. Right, in it goes.
I'm a bit wary of this stuff. It makes you go grey, you know.
But it's the only substance you've made.
Good work. How am I going to say the next bit with space dust in my mouth? Now, remember, those were the days when there were no mobile phones, no MP3 players and no Harry Potter. The Muppet Show had become the biggest TV hit, with millions tuning in every Saturday night. And men everywhere were wearing rather dodgy cardigans, thanks to Saturday Nights with Starsky and Hutch. Take a look at this.
Concorde's maiden flight heralded the dawn of supersonic travel, and Britain sweltered through a long, hot summer with kids keeping cool by dancing to ABBA. When term restarted, the weekends offered little reward for a hard week's slog at school. But in October, all that changed. Suddenly, Saturday mornings on the BBC became an event with the launch of Noel's multicoloured swap shop.
9:30, Saturday morning, welcome indeed.
Within weeks, the ratings went sky high, and kids will be talking about nothing else during double mass on Monday. For parents, the show became a safe babysitter, and it was rumoured to be responsible for a bit of a baby boom.
Gosh!
Swap Shop was bright, breezy, and interactive. It was the first time that children had been given the chance to phone up the telly and talk to a pop star, or to write one of the 100,000 pieces of mail that were sent in every week. Kids were now members of a new club that changed the face of Saturday mornings for good. The team thrived on the show's spontaneity and improvised their way into a new style of television. Cameras roamed around the set, and for the first time, cameramen were heard to laugh and cheer.
Who boos?
Initially planned for just 12 weeks, this revolutionary show kept children swapping for six multicoloured years and has influenced TV to the present day.
Of course, it must have been quite a change from Newsround to suddenly find yourself in this kind of atmosphere.
Yeah, I mean, 4 days a week I was doing Newsround and being quite serious, and then on Saturday morning I found myself amid all this. Mm-hmm.
And it is worth pointing out how revolutionary this show was for the BBC. Apparently, way up on the sixth floor, all sorts of questions were being asked about this hairy oik who didn't have auto cue or script, you know.
From Radio One.
We were making it up. Yeah. The BBC were really frightened of Swap Shop because we appeared to be making it up as we went along, and yeah, because it was so incredibly popular. But we had to be really responsible. We had to say, you know, if you're swapping something, make sure it's your own, nothing live. And we would have this situation where Keith was always obliged to point out, use public transport to get to the Swapperama, which resulted in moments like this.
The buses that run locally are the 7, the 7A, the 8, the 8A, the 8B, and you couldn't remember them. There was 26 buses that run past this place. Actually, I think we should have a prize for anybody who can remember, well, that lot that are hopefully on the screen at the moment.
And when it came... on the actual show, when I pointed out, you know, please go carefully, I did remind people you could probably be run over by a bus because there were so many of them going there. But it was sort of one of the roles of Swap Shop.
It was,
to be
it? Yeah.
A very responsible entertainer.
Yeah.
And are you now going to reveal how you finally had a major hand, well, actually, one hand, in the success of the show?
I get the light entertainment side.
Yes. Lamb!
Yeah, one Saturday morning, do you remember, things were going a bit wrong. As
one Saturday morning?
And we had a bit of time to fill, and there were all these soft toys around the front there, so I grabbed one and I slipped under the desk and popped up Lamb, and you spoke to Lamb for a little while.
It was the most extraordinary thing. And leading broadcaster between my legs. And then this Lamb. I think you enjoyed it too much, John.
I did. Lamb became quite a star.
Yeah? Are you going to set the scene for 76? 30 years ago, what were we up to?
Well, I have got a school bag from 1976 here. So I'm just going to pick it out. So if you were about 10 years old, this is what you'd have spent your pocket money on. And I don't know how much pocket money you had, but the average child had about 42 pence to spend. So two-thirds of it went on sweets. Sweets that came out for the first time. Double-deckers are out that year. Caramel came out. Annuals are obviously hugely popular. Mm-hmm. The Wombles, well worth mentioning.
Wombles,
because not only were they massive, and in case you missed out on the Wombles, they were these little furry creatures that lived on Wimbledon Common, and they were ahead of their time because they collected up litter. The bloke who wrote the music for the Wombles also wrote the theme music for Swap Shop. Those were banned.
Keith, Maggie's got your balls here.
That was another show I did.
Sorry. Okay, the Judy Annual was offering all sorts of tips, like how you could turn your record player into a spirograph, and then at the back, should you ever be in a situation, let's find the page, where you had to hold a Dalmatian for a considerable amount of time.
What?
They showed you just how to do it. I think you've been very cruel making me do those props, because you know I always used to hate it. I was the only girl on the show and I was bullied into handling all the tricky things.
Oh, we did not bully you.
Oh. Well, no, that's not altogether true. Maggie wasn't the only girl on the team, because we did have probably the first ever celebrity chef. Delia Smith starred on Swap Shop. Would you like me to take a call from Delia Smith? Delia or no Delia? Hello, Delia.
Hello.
Hello, how are you?
I'm good. How are you?
Very, very good.
Right. First thing I want to tell you is I still love you.
Oh, thank you. Shh, keep that bit.
And I love Keith and Maggie and John.
Oh, all right then. So what memories do you have of those days, Delia?
Well, I was on the pilot programme, which was very exciting because they didn't actually know whether it was going to work or not. And I thought that was really, really incredible. And then it became a series. And, I mean, this whole three hours of live television, I just loved the live experience because everything I'd done before was recorded and you had to do it two or three times. And it was just wonderful for me to just come and you did it. And I had such a good time every time I came.
And, of course, every great chef has a brilliant assistant.
Yes. But I never had one like you.
That's one of her better sources, isn't it? Well, Delia, we're going to show something. I appreciate you're on the phone, but we're going to show something. We're now going to show you Delia's best bits.
Good morning.
Good morning.
What will you be making today?
Well, if I've got everything with me, I'm ticking it off here, we should have a date apple and walnut loaf.
I think you've done that before, because it is very easy to shoot it clean out of the bowl.
Go on, just have one little go.
It's like making some mint.
OK, you can make it at a faster speed. I've got to make a confession, first of all, that's I've cheated.
Have you?
I got packet puff pastry. If you use two hands, you'll be quicker.
Oh, will I?
Well, I've made a mistake here, and I'll show the world the mistake I made. I cut a little piece out, but that doesn't matter.
And what are you going to be doing during the summer?
Nothing.
Nothing at all?
No. No, I'm going to have a...
Would you like to come and stay at my place and make lots of this stuff?
You did it with great style. Delia, thank you very much indeed for joining us.
It's a pleasure.
And I'll see you in a couple of weeks for that dinner, you promise.
OK.
Delia Smith! And now, once again, it's time for me to ask that question, where are you, Keith?
Swaps and stuff. We'll come to them a little bit later on, but in the meantime, we had some amazing, recognisable guests on the show. In fact, does anybody recognise this face here? Anybody recognise this face here? Do me a favour, stand up, and just for the audience, just mime what you did on the show. Any ideas? Could you be right? Take a look at this.
I'm going to start it now.
Go, Nicholas. I thought to point out it's not marked. How long has he taken so far?
25 seconds.
25 seconds gone. Oh, brilliant.
If you ever try doing that, that is quite incredible.
37 seconds.
37 seconds.
Nicholas Hammond, can I ask, how old were you then?
16, 17.
16 years of age. And I've got to say, I mean, a lot happened to you after that, didn't it?
Yes, I wrote a book and I went off to...
Right.
University.
And you went to, you've gone off to America and become very wealthy, am I right?
2 days after I graduated, I went to the States and I started a couple of companies back in 96 and sold them in 99 and just been raising kids ever since.
Oh, what a great story, a millionaire and all. Can I just say that especially for tonight's show, this man has come all the way from Atlanta to be here. So, Carl, thank you enough. Very quickly, what do you remember about your moments on the show?
It was very nerve-wracking being that young. It was the first time the Rubik's Cube had ever been on television, so it was sort of introducing that to England.
Well, you did it in 30 seconds. We're going to put you to the test tonight.
So I hear.
Where's your Rubik's Cube? Where is it?
Got one.
We've got Maggie there with a stopwatch.
Let me get my glasses on.
OK, go on, I'll leave it to you.
Yeah. I haven't had my eyes lasered like somebody else has.
OK, do you want to start him off?
OK, here we go. Ready, steady, go!
OK, we'll leave him to that. But meanwhile, I want to move on to this lady over here. Do me a favour. I'm sure they'll recognise your name. Tell everybody your name.
Angela.
And Angela had a fantastic collection because we used to have everything on the show from people collecting jigsaw puzzles and more. What was your amazing collection?
Carrier bags.
In those days, I mean, how old were you?
I was 11.
Oh, God, just take a little look at her picture. You're 11 years old. There you go. With your little bag there. How many carrier bags at the age of 11?
200.
And I suppose that's all waxed and waned now. You just don't do it, do you?
We're done.
No.
We're done.
Oh, he's still doing it. He's done. He's done. How long?
36 seconds.
He did it in 36 seconds! Well done. Thanks very much for being with us. Just very quickly before we go, this lady over here, you're still collecting them. How many carrier bags do you have now?
10,000.
10,000. What? Look, in my pocket here, I've got another one for your collection. Very quickly, I'm looking. Is Maxwell Smith here? Maxwell, this is Maxwell Smith. Maxwell Smith causes a lot of problems on the show. Tell everybody why.
This little fella went missing on a family holiday.
So let's have a look at that item now.
First of all, a little plea for help from a boy and his sister who've lost their teddy bear. Maxwell Smith, who's seven, has written from Rotherham in Yorkshire. He says, will you please help me to find my teddy bear? And he's done a drawing of little Ted for us there. Can you see little Ted? So if anybody has found little Ted and a little chef near Abergele on the A55, please get in touch with me and we'll hand him back to Maxwell and Fiona.
And there is the little bear. Max, it's all yours.
Thank you very much.
John.
Pleasure to be of help, Max. We just gave the bare facts. Swap Shop fast became the talked about TV of the time. Children were even writing into Jim'll Fix It to be one of the people in the phone room. And as one of the anchor presenters on Blue Peter at the time, Leslie Judd got the chance to do just that when she took viewers behind the scenes to see exactly how it all worked.
I was going to be line two operator. Francis gave me a few tips before I took my first call.
You all ready? Yes, well, I think they've opened the lines. We're just about to start. Now, let me explain just briefly about the telephone.
All the details of each call are written down. Name, age, address, telephone number, what the caller wants to ask Noel or one of his guests, or what swaps are being offered.
Oh, it's ringing. All right. We may be ringing you back if Noel is going to speak to you.
Yeah. Here we go.
Okay. Bye. Bye-bye, then.
Hello, multicoloured swap shop. Can I help you? From the moment the lines are open until they close, the swap shop girls don't relax for a second.
Good morning. Multicoloured swap shop here. Can I help you?
Now, not everyone who took part in the show can make it here tonight. One man who was a frequent guest was every kid's favourite artist, Tony Hart.
Hello, Bernadette.
Hello.
Hello.
Can I ask Penny Hart, please? Yes? Can you draw me a little furry kitten, please?
A little furry kitten? Yes. Have you ever seen a kitten get tangled up with cotton and cotton reels?
No.
They do. And then they tend to look rather like this. There you are, Bernadette.
Thank you.
There's a cuddly kitten covered in string.
Thank you.
Unfortunately, Tony is not enjoying the best of health at the moment, but he sent us a message. I really enjoyed being part of Multicoloured Swap Shop for 2 years, and I treasure the two viewers' awards that I won. I send my best wishes for a happy 30th anniversary to all concerned. Tony, we send our very best wishes to you. The moment that it leaked out that we were going to do just one more Swap Shop, not only the BBC has been bubbling with anticipation, but thank you for all the letters and emails and things we've had. Reverend Anne Robertson from Aberdeen says, my brother is 5 years older than me and watched the show every week. However, one week, he decided that he wanted a train set and he asked if he could phone in. My parents said yes, but it wasn't until later that my parents thought to ask him what he was going to swap. And his answer was, my sister. The lines were busy and he didn't get through. Matthew Arnold in Porthcawl says, I called every week with all sorts of fun stuff to swap, but alas, I never got through, except once when I rang at 9:30 and got through to a lady who put me on hold. I was still holding at 1 p.m, well into grandstand. My parents went nuts with the phone bill. Keith!
This is Beverly Reeve. Give her a round of applause. Lovely.
Beverly, do me a favour, tell everybody your story.
Well, basically, when I was 5 years old, myself and my sister entered a competition. And, yes, I won a wonderful jumper.
OK, well, talking of that jumper, it was to do with B.A. Robertson. Now, B.A. Robertson wrote the second theme tune for Swap Shop. So let's have a look at you in action.
Beverly, have you tried wearing it at all? Have you tried putting it on? You have? Oh. And what happened?
Well,
she's only small. I know. She's only small. She'll grow into it, won't you? Will you get bigger so you can fill it?
Yes. And the other very special thing, it's a sad thing, actually, we've actually lost a lot of footage of Swap Shop, but that was your copy, wasn't it?
Yes, it was.
So does that come out every Christmas and you watch it?
It's come out on more than one occasion and embarrassed both myself and my sister for many, many years. And, okay. And will no doubt do so for many years.
Do me a favour, give them the big twirl. Look at this. Fantastic.
Hey, Beverly Reeve, thanks very much.
And you've got a question for Noel, haven't you, Maggie?
Well, Eileen from North Wales was determined to have the full Noel Edmonds experience tonight. As a picture of her, she has knitted a sweater for you.
Oh, that's
beautifully understated, as you can tell. And I have it here. Look at that.
Very kind.
All your colours.
He's got every colour, yes.
And of course, there was another bloke on the team who really loved his sweaters. He's not sitting too far away from me. And just to show just how global this programme is, Sanchita Gupta, I've got a picture of her here. She hails from New Delhi in India. And she has knitted, he's looking surprised because he doesn't know about this.
No, I didn't.
A sweater for you, which oh, I have here. Now, this is great. Look at this.
Oh, fantastic.
That's
well,
very special.
Thank you, Cynthia. That's wonderful.
Now, Maggie.
Yeah.
Pot and kettle, people in glass houses. You're setting yourself up here for a bit of a fall when it comes to fashion items.
Right.
Just have a look at this.
They're smashing.
Very good.
I've had lots of jokes about this morning, so I don't want any from you as well.
Come on, down a bit, down a bit. Good morning. Did you see Maggie's legs then?
Yeah.
What did you think?
What are you doing?
I just couldn't find a parking space.
I can't help but notice that your chest is flashing at
me. Put the lights just down a little bit, please, so we can see the full glory of Maggie's...
Flashing
special. Yes. It's nice of Andy Pandy to let you out today, by the way.
Hang on, there is one more as well. I think this must have been one of the swap shop books or something. Just have a look at this. Look!
You can build your own Maggie.
Oh, no, that picture will haunt me forever. Anyway, moving swiftly on. One of the things I really loved about the programme was the way you only had to mention something really casually and you would write in. And one day I'd said, I'm going to cut my hair, and maybe bearing in mind my poor fashion sense, you tried to rescue me and you sent in hundreds and hundreds of pictures. And I looked around the set, I couldn't bear to think that they were going to be thrown away, so I kept them. They've been in my attic. Now, this is a look I thought was particularly good. And you've got one there. John's got another one.
It's a good likeness, isn't it?
And then on the back of this one, I love this. This little girl, she's Karen Hopcutt, and she says, I'm 11 years old, I'm very interested in hairstyling, and I think I follow after my mum because she was a hairdresser for many years, but she now works in a fish and chippy.
Well, competitions were a major part of Saturday mornings, of course, and not least the competitions that we ran when a celebrity guest would bring in an item as a prize. But when we've been going through the archives, some of those prizes were, well, let's just say, not exactly what every young boy or girl was desperate for.
Swap time. Well, when I was last on Swap Shop, I brought some of my apple chutney in. So there is my green tomato chutney.
What's all this rubbish you brought along?
Well, it's Radio 2 rubbish. If you just... Look. Observe. A Radio 2 sponge grows before your very eyes, ladies and gentlemen.
This is a red shirt. A red see-through shirt, which I wore in the Prince Charming review.
I see you brought along some swimming trunks.
Yes, these, in fact, were the swimming trunks I wore in the Moscow final.
The main swap is to do with the question. You have to ask a question.
Yes.
To win the swap.
Yes.
The main swap is this down here. This box. It's a copy of one at Hampton Court, possibly used by Queen Elizabeth I. The question is, what is it? What's in the box?
Yeah. Now, think of a number was a hugely successful show hosted by this man, Johnny Book. What
earth went through your mind that your swap was a commode?
Well...
We brought a commode.
We'd done it in a programme. We used it in a programme and it was a star thing and we had it made and it's exactly a replica of the one that they used to go on, apparently. But it was empty. I have to say, it was empty. But we thought we'd give it away. It was only a box covered in... and that's so I swapped it.
What do you remember of those Saturday morning occasions?
I remember I used to try and do stunts. I used to have kids pick me up and people pick me up and I used to balance people on brushes. Mm-hmm. And, of course, I brought my kids.
Yeah.
And that was lovely because the first time they... Because with my shows, they were in Bristol. I never took my kids because it was work, really, you know. But with Swap Shop, it was a jolly, you know. And we used to love it. It was just lovely to be on.
I'm so pleased you said that because we actually, as we were delving through the archives, we found this wonderful clip of Johnny and his kids.
I forgot. It's my little lad's birthday. He's up here. Can we have a look? It's Dan.
Where is he?
Eight. There he is. Give us a wave, Dan. There's Rizzo.
Happy birthday.
My daughter. Ah, oh, they're shy because Dad's on, you see. His birthday's seven today.
Oh, seven.
And his brother couldn't come because he's at school.
Oh. Yeah.
Can we just have that back again, please? Can you just pop it up one more time? Doesn't Zoe look serious? How old was Zoe then?
Zoe was 14, going on 18. As kids are at the age.
And was there anything about her being around television that triggered her interest?
She always wanted to be in the business, but never, ever discussed it with me or her mum. Never mentioned it. It was just there. Mm. And as soon as she left school at 18, she'd done amateur dramatics and things. And very soon she was in, researching. Research with Michaela Strachan, that's how she got started.
Mm. Have you got anything better for us in...
Well, I used to swap chemistry sets, which I used to be involved in,
yeah.
But I don't have any, so I've got a physics set. But the other thing I have, and these are collector's items, these really are going for a lot of money. This is a 79-80, the original Think of a Number book, signed by me.
OK, if you want to swap with Johnny, this is how we play it. Hold it up as high as you can, let's have a look. Ooh. We've got the famous mousetrap game that was always there.
Ooh.
We've got some antiques, and that's just Ooh. The audience.
Have I got a cheat?
No. Oh, we've got the Swap Shop board game, fantastic. We got the Gotcha Oscars, I remember that. I think I'm on that tape. Lovely, never got commissioned for it. We've got Madonna's Immaculate Collection. We've got a jumping kangaroo. Oh, my gosh, we've got so much stuff.
What's that one? What's the book there? What's
Hang on,
that?
I'm going to go... this here?
Yeah.
That's the Gotchas video. It's on sale in good retail stores.
Yeah,
it's
come
on eBay
come
at the moment.
How did you plant that? Something very simple.
Something
I don't
very
know.
Simple.
I don't mind. The slippers on the front row.
Oh, my
But I've always wanted. Thank you very much.
Hang on,
They
hang
suit
on.
My age, you understand.
A pair of slippers. Which hotel did you nick them from? Hey, you stole them.
It was given to me.
Rubbish. I bet you've got the dressing gown as well.
Hey, and the towel.
She's got the towel as well. OK, I have been done. I was in Whitchurch once, and on TV I was actually done for swapping stolen radios that a kid gave me. OK, Johnny, the slippers are yours.
Wonderful.
And you've won that thing there.
Ladies and gentlemen... Johnny Ball. Now, again... One of the very best things about doing this show has not only been finding the collectors, but discovering what's happened to them since they appeared all those years ago. The piece of footage you're about to see actually no longer exists in the BBC archive. A lot of really great stuff was destroyed, but this was sent in by two friends whom we'll be meeting in a moment. But just, well, take a look at this.
Come down here and tell me about some of these, the ones that you've got here. So do you spend a lot of your time making mistakes and rubbing like mad?
No.
Well, I like that foot. That's good, isn't it? Can you see that? That's lovely. Right. Now, are there any particular rubbers that you're looking for? Any special ones you want?
Really unusual. Very unusual ones.
Unusual.
If anybody's got a Snoopy one,
you'd like a Snoopy one? Who's this?
Timothy Coulter.
Hello, Timothy. You're through to Samantha. Can you hear him all right?
Yes.
What are you offering?
I've got a Snoopy about 2 inches tall.
How about that?
Is it a rubber? Yes.
It is a rubber.
And it's from the United States of America.
Thank you very much, Timothy. Thanks for ringing.
Yes,
bye-bye.
Bye.
Hello.
Well, as you can see,
Samantha and Lucy have joined me here. How old were you then, ladies?
Nine.
OK, and you've brought along some of your rubbers.
Quiet, quiet, quiet.
I kept a straight face 30 years ago. So can you now. So you've still maintained the collection?
We have. Our children now collect them.
Yeah? And where is the Snoopy rubber?
We never got it.
Oh, a bit more sincerity to it. We always prided ourselves on the fact that everyone was very honest and that even though we weren't actually managing it, that the swap would go ahead, but you never got it.
No, we've waited and we've looked for Timothy Torture, but no rubber.
Oh, well, as you would expect for this special show, we traced him and we've got him. No, we're going to find it. Swap Shot never gives up. We're going to finalise this in your favour, I hope. Now, I do understand that there was a bit of a row between the two of you before that phone call as to who was going to actually make it. Yeah?
Yeah, big argument.
And who won? Well, obviously you won, didn't you? So, bearing in mind we've only got one trim phone for you, I think it really ought to be your opportunity.
I'm shy now, though.
Oh, God, there you go. And hopefully we have got Timothy Tolcher in New Zealand. Hello, Timothy.
Hello, Noel.
Hello. Well, good evening, or should I say good morning to you?
It's good morning, yeah. It's a beautiful morning here as well.
Well, welcome to Swap Shop again. Sorry about the 30-year break, but we've been busy doing other things. Now, you offered a Snoopy rubber to these two charming ladies, and you didn't send it.
I know, I feel very bad. It's been...
That didn't sound very sincere, Tim. You reneged on a swap, which is a cardinal sin. Explain yourself, sir. Explain yourself.
Well, I was watching the swap shop. This is what I remember anyway. And these two girls were collecting Snoopies. And I realised that my brother had a Snoopy rubber. So I thought, well, this could be quite an easy way to get on television. So I rang through and was on television. I got through, spoke to the girls. And then in all my excitement, I just put the phone down after the phone call and realised that I didn't have any details of where I should swap, who I should swap with.
Oh, yeah.
And, then I tried to call back, and then, of course, it got too busy, I never managed to get through again.
Yeah, that's not plausible. That doesn't wash with me, because I've seen a picture of you when you were a little lad at the time, and I think it's a giveaway. Look at that. You look like a cross between John Motson and Del Boy. He's got the sheepskin coat. You were a bit of a wide boy at that time, weren't you? Well, we're going to put it.
I was, but that is the honest truth.
Yeah, we're going to put it to the vote here. Do you believe Timothy Tolcher's story? Put your hands up if you believe it. 100% guilty.
Oh dear.
But I'm going to get you off the hook, Timothy, because we actually did manage to find a Snoopy rubber. So, Tim, thank you for joining us. I'm glad we found you, and you are off the hook, even though you admitted you were guilty.
Thanks very much.
Thanks for joining us. Bye. Bye. And, I don't know what you're going to... There's going to be another row between these two, isn't there? Yes. Well, there it is. I'm afraid we only managed to find one, but your collection is now complete. And as we always said, in the end, Swap Shop delivers. Ladies, thank you very much indeed.
Thank you. So nice to see them all wearing their Swap Shop hats. Makes a change to me. I'm enjoying the warmth of the studio tonight, but I can tell you, trust me, I've carved a little niche for myself with running up and down streets and outside broadcast. So somebody's got to do it, and I'm not knocking it. Knocking. Moving on. Truly, some of the best memories for me were on the outside broadcast on Swap Shop. Take a look.
I wonder where Keith is this week.
Good morning.
Ooh, it's absolutely freezing. Yes. Good morning, Noel.
Hello, Keith.
Keith, where are you, Keith?
Good morning.
It was at this moment each week that the top secret location of Swapperama was revealed.
Keith, where are you?
I'm in Cornwall, in Pontypool. I'm on the northwest coast of Britain.
This morning, I'm actually in London.
The suspense was over and thousands could pull on their parkas and come on down.
Now, the buses that run locally are the 14, the 5, the 4, the 3, the 2 and the 1.
Swappers came armed with games, jigsaws, absolutely anything they could find to swap.
Hello? I've come here to swap, so let's have a look at your swap. Any offers for a Monopoly? Any offers for staying alive? There we go. You take hold of that. And I'll take hold of that and pass it to my friend over the way here. Thanks very much.
What are you swapping then? Silly of me to ask. A load of badges there. Any offers for some badges?
And we could always rely on the children to be the stars.
Can you see his shoes? Come here. Look at his shoes. You've got your shoes on the wrong way round this morning.
Wrong way?
What time did you get up?
I don't know.
Anyway, what have you got to swap this morning?
And inevitably, there were a few technical problems along the way.
What's the weather like in London, though?
Well, it's black ice and it's very much the way you left it when you went yesterday.
I can't hear you at all, unfortunately. I really can't.
I've got one end of the cable here. Now, if I give this a little pull, there'll be a delay, but it ought to pull at your end. That's it?
We can't hear you!
You can't hear me at all?
No!
Hold on.
Yes, that's it. That's
can you hear me now?
Yes.
Is that good?
Yes.
You see, I mean, I know how to work these things, you know. I'll see you a bit later on, eh?
Oh, being stolen goods the lot I did. Can't tell you. Fantastic times, great memories for me.
Well, you've got a fantastic memory. Tell everybody that story about Sheffield.
Oh, gosh, we went to Sheffield, right, and we have an earpiece in the ear so the director could talk to you. And I was on this outside broadcast with all the kids there, and the director went, oh, my God, he said, can you go to your right, because there's a kid with a fag on. So I went to my right, right, and he went, oh, blooming heck, no, go back. He said, there's a kid with a can of pale ale.
So funny.
Well, he's got the memory, and it could come in very handy because it's quiz time.
Hey!
And the first one is for you, Keith.
Oh, it's not, is it?
Yeah.
Oh, right.
And it quite simply is, where are you, Keith?
Oh, as I say, we're going to be having a look at all the different types of engine, all the different types of rolling stock, and also I'm going to be meeting an engine that has starred in a very, very well-known series of books. I'm sure you've all heard of Thomas the Tank. Oh, PC. Peterborough. There you go.
Oh, well done.
The Lean Valley Railway. And actually, when we were there, we actually did that twice, that link. The reason being is because the train driver didn't hear us. And rather than coming towards the camera, live on TV, we backed out. Was I right?
You were right, yeah.
I could. Yeah, yeah. Hey!
Now, this is all totally genuine. Who was the star guest on the very first show, guys?
Is that for all of us?
Yeah.
Flintlock and Cliff Richard. No, Flintlock were on the show, the band.
No.
No.
Star guest.
Tom Baker.
Yes.
Oh,
Tom
yes.
Baker. Doctor Who.
Yes, very good.
Yeah. Well done, John.
Have a look. Yeah. Have a look.
But if anybody out there would like to guess how long my scar is and write it on a postcard and send it to Noel Edmonds at Swap Shop, and if you guess right, then in return for that, I'll send you a Doctor Who scarf.
Eric, you were meant to come in when I said Eric, but anyway.
Thank you, Eric.
Thank you very much. Oh, says Noel, this one's for you. Pick up the phone. There's an old pal of the show who has a question for you. Hello.
Hi, Noel. It's your surprise. It's Cliff Richard here.
Hey!
Fantastic.
No, now look, I know you've been celebrating 30 years of Saturday morning television, so my question to you is,
yeah,
how many times did I appear on the shows?
Oh, wow. Oh,
all together.
Wow.
Four.
Was that as well?
Probably
four or five.
I would 6 years. Hi. I mean, it was every seven times. I would have thought. Seven times.
Uh-oh. Sorry, Noel. It was actually, I can hardly believe it, 8 times. Oh. Anyway, whatever, have a fantastic evening, and I'm wishing you all a happy 30th. And years to the next 30 years.
Thanks, Chris.
Bye-bye to you all.
All right, well, we'll do... We'll do a bit more quizzing in a while, and we've got plenty more to come on the show. As well as Cliff Richard, there were quite literally hundreds of bands and artists who appeared on Saturday morning. So we put together a top 10 of your favourite performers.
At 10, The Pretenders. 9, Nick Kershaw. In at 8, Bob Geldof and the Boomtown Rats. Wet, Wet, Wet storm in at 7. At 6, Boyzone. 5, Duran Duran. The Spice Girls power in at 4. 3, Wham. At 2, Elton John. And at number 1, the boys are back for good. It's Take That. Baby, I want you.
Plugger responsible for Take That, Spice Girls and Kylie. Hello, Nikki.
Hello.
Hi. How important was Saturday morning television to the record industry?
Oh, it was practically the number one show. You had Saturday mornings and Top of the Pops, but Saturdays made such a difference because not only did you have millions of people watching the show, but there wasn't the variety that you have now, so everybody watched it. And if your band was on in the morning, you hoped, and it worked, that people went out and bought the single in the afternoon and it would fly up the charts.
So what tactics did you use to actually get artists on the show?
Well, it wasn't any bribery, it wasn't any blackmailing, but, I mean, you would do anything. If you turned up, there was a lady called Kathy Gilby who was a legend in the industry. Everybody knew Kathy, and we would literally, all the pluggers would queue up for hours waiting to see her, because if she gave you the nod, that was it. Your band were on and you were away. So T-shirts, CDs, you know, anything that the show wanted that you would try and help with to get your acts on. But, you know, she was very, very strict. She wouldn't take any backhanders, you know. No money changed hands, I hate to tell you, but we did try anything and everything.
Well, Kathy's a great character, know her quite well. And I believe you could really say she was responsible for Take That getting their first big break when she saw a picture of them in a magazine and said, that's the band I want on Saturday. Is that true?
Yeah, that's true. Well, Kathy said when, I mean, she was brilliant because she had such a passion. And I can remember going in once and I was plugging my acts, as you do, and she looked at this magazine and she went, now look at that, Nikki, and it was a magazine called Fast Forward.
Well, there's the picture.
Yeah, look at that. And she said, that's exactly what I want on my show. If you can find me those boys, I'll have them on my show. That's what we need. That's what the industry needs. So I literally went back to the record company, spoke to the A&R man, and he said, you know, we're looking at them. We're interested in signing them. And that was the decision. It really did make them make that final decision. And, of course, she supported them throughout their career.
Well, Take That became firm favourites for girls across the country. And, in fact, in the time of going live, they made a very memorable appearance. Thankfully, this is one that did remain in the archives.
Who's your favourite pop group?
Take That.
Who?
Take That.
Who are they?
Pop group.
Are they? Are they any good?
Brilliant.
She's crying.
Donna,
we're going
to cut you some crap. It's all right.
It's all right.
It's great.
So who's the best?
Yeah. Why can't I wake up with you? So you're there when I open my eyes.
Am I right in thinking there was a behind-the-scenes drama about that whole thing?
Yeah, that looks like it's going swimmingly well, doesn't it? But if you notice, they're actually cooking her breakfast. So they were meant to be on the top of the show right at the beginning. Now, I was ill, So my colleague said, don't worry, I'll drive them in the van, I'll sort it out. So there he is, picks them up from Manchester, drives around Manchester, not a map, nothing. I'm on my brick of a mobile saying, where are you? And literally, I think they got to her house. It must have been at least 2 hours late. The show was finishing as they arrived, so they had to rush through and cook her this meal. So it nearly didn't happen.
Well, she's here. We've got Donna Buchanan. Whoa. Hello, Donna.
Donna! Fantastic! My God. So is it as clear as a bell to you?
Absolutely.
You've not forgotten that moment?
Not a moment.
So what were the memorable moments of that day when you got the knock on the door?
I just felt like the luckiest girl on the planet at the time. They were the biggest band that were coming forward, and I was just the luckiest girl on the planet.
And you had no idea.
Whatsoever.
Yeah. And what was the reaction from your friends?
Jealous.
Really? Yeah. We've got something very special for you tonight. And Nikki, you've got it there, haven't you?
I have. Something very special indeed. Donna,
look.
This is from the boys themselves to say thank you for your patience, making you stand there for hours waiting for them, unaware of what was going on. So to present it to you on behalf of them, thank you very much for your support of
Nikki Buchanan.
In today's 24-hour multi-channel digital interactive television environment, it's very difficult to imagine an era where television actually had its own glamour, its own aura. And back in the 1970s, by doing this kind of thing with the latest handheld camera technology, Swap Shop stripped away that whole veneer of glamour. We went behind the scenes. I can remember we went to the prop department and bumped into Daleks and Cybermen. We went downstairs here at the television centre into the videotape department and saw how they recorded things like the cup final and that kind of thing. And, of course, we went to the dressing rooms. Madonna.
Sorry.
Oh, sorry. And what's this one? Tom Cruise, yeah. And we basically crashed into stars like Robin Hood, went behind the scenes in all sorts of different shows. Posh Boy's got a good dressing room there. And we, I think, energised a whole generation of kids. I know for a fact that Philip Schofield was inspired to get into television from watching Swap Shop. Chris Evans talks with a great fondness about the times that he was watching Saturday morning television and decided, yes, he wanted to become a disc jockey. And Chris Moyles talks a lot on Radio 1 about those heady days of Saturday morning television. So it was fantastic to have this power. I mean, I just loved it. The ability to go out of one studio, go round the premier broadcasting establishment in the world and just burst into almost any area and say hello to somebody. Mr. Henry, how are we?
Hello. How are you? Am I using this?
You're using that.
My friend Lenny. Good morning.
Lenny, you were the opposition. You were the rivals. You were the anarchic mob, weren't you,
yeah.
On Tiswas?
I think Tiswas was... we were yobbos, really. I mean, you were the kind of boy that mums wanted to come home and hang out with their daughters, and we were the ones that were in climbing in through the kitchen window, rifling through your purse. But it was good, actually. It was good that you were the sensible ones and we were the anarchic ones, because it was a balance, you know, and you needed us and we needed you.
Yeah.
Because, you know, Tarrant would often go, this is it! You don't get this on Swap Shop, pal! This is it! And then the camera would go right into his mouth, you know. No one ever, this is what they want. And what was great about it was this idea that he could, even though you were doing your show and you were, he could talk to you down the camera. And it was just, and I think it led to things like, you know, this, you know, where people can really go off on one and enjoy yeah. themselves on the telly. And then I think Swap Shop had a poise, you know, and you had a definite structure. Whereas often, Tiswas looked structureless, and that was probably its charm. I certainly enjoyed it.
But you were instrumental in introducing comedy into Saturday morning children's TV.
Well, I don't know whether I was instrumental, but I do remember talking to Chris Bellinger, who was editor of various Saturday morning shows, and I came to Superstore near the end, and I remember it being a good show, but it was like church. I'm exaggerating. But the atmosphere in the studio was a bit cold and there was no kids around and it was people being very reverent. And I just thought, I said, this is bollocks. That's what I actually said. But what I wanted to say was, you should have kids around because it's life, you know, you should have noise. And it should be funny. Why aren't there more comics here? Or just get somebody to be funny in the studio and the cameraman will laugh, you know. And I know they used to laugh at stuff you said and stuff Mike said, but actually it's not the same as somebody over in the corner with a dedicated purpose to make the audience laugh. And I think that's when they got Trevor and Simon.
Yeah.
And I was a pants-swinging fool when I saw those guys. I love those guys, swinging your pants. And I love the kind of... The evolution of it, you know, from Philip and Sarah, who I thought were a very strong combination, to Andy and all those weird puppets in the studio, it just became mad. So actually, I think the BBC took over then. I think the BBC took over with anarchy in the studio and loads of characters and puppets and comedians over there and people popping up all over the place and doing silly things. It sort of went too mad, really.
Okay, now how do I shut you up?
You take the mic away.
Okay, right.
Remember, I am on two of yours. It is here. Where are you from? From mid-January to April. It is a brilliant show examining humour and everything all over the world. You cannot stop me, Noel. I am here. I say, open that box. Oh, no, it is only £1.50. I am disgraced. I'm disappointed.
Right, hand over to John Craven.
And now, John Craven. He'll probably be in a jumper, but bear with him. He's a nice man, but very old.
Now, let's go to the year of 1982, and the must-have gadget was a Sony Pocket Television. For girls, it was rah-rahs, and for boys, BMXs. The Little Britain and Catherine Tate of the time involved four outrageous characters that the nation got to know as the Young Ones. In the cinemas, E.T. wore a hoodie, Dustin Hoffman wore a dress in Tootsie, and Harrison Ford went to war in Blade Runner. And a new king of Saturday mornings took the throne in the same year as a future king was born.
In 1982, Britain braced itself for war as Mrs. Thatcher's Armada set sail for the Falkland Islands. At home, Channel 4 signalled the start of a multimedia age, while Culture Club shot the old guard and encouraged kids to slap on mum's makeup. But there was one event that was talked about in every playground. After six meteoric years, Swap Shop closed for business.
From the Swap Shop team, goodbye.
Before the tears could dry, Mike Reed's Saturday Superstore opened.
Hello, I'm Mike Reed. It's 9:30 on Saturday morning and time for me to open the Saturday Superstore.
The simple shop was replaced by a modern superstore with David Icke in the sports department. And the show offered bargains instead of swaps. Blue Peter's Sarah Green became the co-presenter. Hello. And when Keith wasn't in the warehouse, he toured the country in the delivery van. And I did the news. Saturday's Superstore enjoyed a stellar guest list as politicians, pop stars and celebs, nagged by their kids, realised the true potential of Saturday morning TV.
Not that easy to communicate with Keith Chegwin, believe me. But this was a foolproof way of doing it in the new era.
Oh, I can hear banging upstairs. Hang on. Can you just hang on a minute? No! I'll be back with you in a mo. I'm down in the basement of Saturday Superstore. I used to spend many hours down here. Oh, my gosh! Mike Reed!
Hey!
Mike. So good to see you.
Thank you.
What a great mate to work with. Hey, and can I say, I mean, was it a tough act to follow, Noel Edmonds on Swap Shop?
It was great, because Noel had done Radio 1 Breakfast Show. I think I just started doing the breakfast show.
Is that why you think you got the job? Because you were both DJs in the morning, both popular shows?
I don't know why I got it, but I remember where I was. I was in the crypt of St Paul's when I heard I got it. doing something for the BBC Diamond Jubilee. And the royal family were there and all these great faces from the past. And it was so overawing that somebody said, you've got the Saturday morning show. And I said, oh, great. And it was only afterwards that I thought, hey, well, I've got it. It's great.
Great. Tough telly for you, though. Hmm? Tough telly.
Oh, great fun. Just great fun. I mean, like you and Noel and Maggie enjoyed it. It was just a great thing on Saturday mornings, having your mates around, having a bit of fun. You know, poke me with a stick, 9 o'clock, here we go. Let's have a laugh.
All right. Hey, but also with us was Crow!
Yeah!
He's here!
Oh, Jesus. Hey, who put that underneath? Malcolm. Crow is back on Malcolm.
Was he a tough act to work with?
Crow was, yeah. Because underneath here are the little feet working, Crow, you see. I used to pull the hairs out of my legs. When I was trying to do something serious, I used to go, ah! So
So if I had any tea or anything I didn't want, I'd just pour it under the desk. I'd say I'd throw it away.
Great.
But, yeah.
Oh, will you stop it? It was a great show. We had a great legion of fans. I'll tell you, let's have a look at some of the highlights.
Here we go, lads.
We're going to try a bit of an experiment. We ready?
New zany image. Mike, off you go.
Good morning.
That's it.
It's 9 o'clock. It's Saturday.
And fingers crossed.
You've guessed it, time for...
Superstore gave Saturday mornings a new look.
I'm Mike Reed.
I'm Sarah Green.
I'm Vicky Licorice.
I'm Scarlett.
The team thrived in an atmosphere of organised chaos.
The switchboard over here, ready to take your calls.
Hello, Keith, it's Mike there, it's Crow.
Oh, I could. No, he's not. Have you tried the coffee shop?
Will you let go?
Each week, the show reviewed the latest pop offerings.
Is it a hit? Is it a miss? We'll find out as we go upstairs with the pop panel!
Right.
I thought their costumes were pretty. They've gone to a lot of trouble with those and they look quite nice.
I liked it.
Three of you. Yes. Would you dance to it?
No, I wouldn't, because there was no melody. There certainly was rhythm. You could do a movement to it. You could do a movement to any rhythm. You could do a movement to a drum without having any song.
Kids got to show off their talents on Search for a Superstar. And Keith got even more adventurous out on the road.
Geronimo! Oh, gosh, I'm going to peel off to meet one of our special guests. Hang on. Right now, we're going up 130 foot, thanks to...
But in all the mayhem, manager Mike Reed remained unflappable.
Welcome back. As you can see, we're all having fun here. We've got...
Well, I think the thing that was admirable with Swap Shop and Saturday Superstore, mm-hmm. that we weren't afraid to tackle difficult issues, were we?
No, we weren't. I'm wondering when the Sibirga disaster happened. It was an extraordinary morning, because normally now they cut away to Rolling News or something like that, but they wouldn't stick with children's TV now. But they stuck with us, and I remember saying, sit, we're coming back, and you had to deal with this and go from gravitas to levity in 60 seconds and come back and say, and now we've got Adam Ant with us. And then come out of Roadrunner, the cartoon, and in 60 seconds, just take it down, and we're going back to Zeebrugge. So it was great that they thought the program, the Swap Shop Superstore type program, could deal with those sort of issues, because we were doing that. We were a sort of magazine program and a pop program, but we were presenters and trained, so we could deal with that.
And what were your favourite people that you interviewed on the show? Because we had some real big stars like Paul McCartney and more.
Yeah, I mean, to have the political leaders on, have Margaret Thatcher on, and Neil Kinnock. We gave so many people their chances as well, didn't we? Like Aha, Nick Kershaw, Wham, all did
wet,
their
wet,
first...
Wet,
wet, wet. Wet, all did their first shows on there as well. But some great moments. I mean, great
moments... What about Malcolm?
Little Malcolm. There was a little crow Malcolm.
Oh,
yeah,
yes.
Little Malcolm. And he was so sweet. Remember, Sarah loved Malcolm, and for weeks... She'd go, oh, little Malcolm.
It's the
about
best
3 weeks
I
to realise it was Judd's hand.
Mike, for the moment, thank you very much. Cheers. Well, a great part of the series was the Saturday Superstore Search for a Superstar. Think sort of like Junior X Factor with not so nasty judges. Take a look.
It's horrible being in love and you're 8 and up. I got your picture on me wall, got your name upon me scarf. Oh, it's horrible being in love, horrible being in love, and you're 8 and up. Oh, she's a fighty lass, a bunny with lasses, bunny with gin in the pot. I gave my mother some kismet ring and a bunny with tat to show. I met her in the woods and in the proper in the fall. Well, I was the best man and she was about the ball. My nose in place. Have I got a cute expression on my face? Are my blue eyes bright? Do I look alright to be taken home Christmas Day?
And now, another round from our quiz.
It's totally genuine, they don't know about this, so I want you to watch this clip from Superstore's famous pop panel and tell me, who is Elton John talking about?
I liked some of her records, but she's a bit faceless, I think.
Ooh.
Ooh, that was faceless.
Can I guess?
Faceless.
Can I guess?
Well, how else are we going to learn what you're thinking?
No, I thought
we
Mike
could
might
guess
it,
what he's guessing.
But yeah, I thought Mike might know it. Was he talking about Madonna?
Okay, let's see the answer.
I liked some of her records, but she's a bit faceless, I think. She's one of these people you can, if she walked down the street, you wouldn't say, "Ah, there's Madonna."
Huh? Yes! Oh!
Can you remember the name of this colourful band?
Morning, good morning.
Good morning.
I see you dressed in your normal Saturday morning gear here, which looks terrific.
Yeah, I've got a fuzz box and I'm going to use it.
Yes.
Yeah, they were probably there talking about their hit.
Yeah, they were. Yeah, the full answer down here was Fuzzbox, also affectionately known as the Poptastic Punkettes. And the band had hit singles in the 80s. This is fantastic bit of telly, this is. Now, I wonder how much you remember
this. Yeah, so the question is, what was so special about Bux Fizz's appearance on the outside broadcast at the Channel Islands? Any ideas?
Mm. Oh, I thought I was waiting for a clip. I know this. I know.
Wait a minute, how come you know all these?
Because I was on Saturday Superstore and I was on the outside broadcast that day with them. Yeah, I was actually in the Channel Islands. I think we were in Jersey or Guernsey. And what happened was two of them got on the plane and two didn't get on the plane. So what we did, and it was quite clever in those days, we matched them up. So we had two of them in Jersey or Guernsey and we had the other two in London.
Was the song Run For Your Life?
Well, we can show you. Yeah. The original footage
doesn't exist, does it?
No, no. But someone has sent in a video. So let's take a look.
Can you hear us? Oh, marvellous. There they are. Hello, folks.
Sorry, I love
it, John,
for your life.
Yeah, well done. Yeah.
And we will now move on. Well, music acts and record companies had recognised the power of Saturday morning television, and it didn't take long for other big names in the entertainment industry to realise that a Saturday morning wake-up call was indeed a VIP appointment.
At 10, the soap star turned diva from Down Under.
Well, Charlene's going out with Scott. I'm not going out with Jason, however.
Number 9, the Peter Pan of pop.
I wore it on stage then. It's really nice.
Yeah.
And I thought, if a girl won it, it's a great disco outfit, and if a boy wins it, you better get into a band.
In at 8, the British Bulldog.
Over my shoulder, like this, and slam it right through the mud.
7, it's the former policeman, Sting.
I make films because people ask me to, and I like learning how to act.
6, Sir Paul.
It's a record breaker.
At 5, Richard Branson sent ratings through the roof when he appeared.
If I only had £5, what would I spend it on? A pair of underpants.
Take that, take 4.
Do you ever feel bad about the pressure fame puts on your family?
Sometimes.
She's still there.
She's still there.
At 3, Billy Connolly.
I think I just found being a comedian by mistake, and it's a great feeling.
In at 2, Terry Waite in one of his first TV interviews since his release.
Hostage taking and terrorism often arises, comes in situations where people are very frustrated, fed up.
In at 1, the first time a British Prime Minister took live calls on children's television.
Hello, Alison.
Hello. In the event of a nuclear war, where will you be?
Oh, my goodness me. Well, now, look, the whole point of having nuclear weapons is to stop a war of any kind.
But if there is one, where will you be?
I should be in London.
Oh, don't you have your own bunker or something?
Look, dear, let me again point out, the possession of these weapons has kept the peace for 40 years.
Well, here is that girl who caught the Prime Minister off guard. Not many people have ever done that, Alison. Was it your own question?
It was indeed, yes.
Because I know that Dennis Thatcher came with her and he thought that question had been planted.
Oh,
No, 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 not at all. All my own work.
And why did you want to know that? I mean, why did you want to know about the nuclear bunkers?
I think it was just something that was very important at the time. I think the women at Greenham Common were doing their thing, and there were some films about the matter, When the Wind Blows, Raymond Briggs. And it was just a matter close to my own heart.
And how old were you then? I think we've got 14, a picture of you.
Yeah.
There you are.
20 years ago.
Yeah, you certainly made the news the next day,
didn't you?
It was all over the Sunday papers.
It was.
You know, you're the girl, Maggie Bunker by phone in schoolgirl.
Yeah, absolutely.
Jeremy Paxman must have been furious. But has it ever made you want to be a political journalist or anything like that?
No, not so. Well, I did. I was aspiring to a career in journalism, but then I changed course somewhat, and now I'm using my cross-examination techniques in the law.
Well, thank you for putting the superstore in the headlines. Well done, Alison. Noel.
But there were plenty more moments that kept us all enthralled, and these actually are your favourite ghastly moments, as voted by you on our website. One
step in at number 10, what a fine pair of pins.
Oh.
Number 9, watch out, it's not just Keith's feet causing him embarrassment. I've got two left feet, my mind's making promises, my body can't keep. Ooh, I'm making promises, I'm losing sleep. All those things are me. At 8, David Icke takes a tumble.
Come on. Icke. Oh, that's it, through the finish. Whoa! Okay, just
well done, John.
You can see the bit of danger in it now.
At number 7, a teacher with an unusual talent. At 6, John Craven's exposed.
A very famous impresario has had a hand in the Lamb's success.
Lamb in the nude.
In at 5, Keith actually lost for words.
Gosh! Oh, I don't. Oh! Oh! Oh!
At number 4, Peter Simon says, let's all fall down. In at 3, it's puppy love for Gordon the Gopher. Five-star at 2, face their harshest critic.
OK, Elliot, what's your question?
I'd like to ask five-star where this like, fucking crap, the fucking mother...
Thanks very much, Elliot. Nice to meet you.
I think that was a bit unnecessary. I never thought five-star were that bad. Well, I did, actually, but I wouldn't quite have expressed it that way. We all got used to the odd guest turning up with a hangover, but it was a unique moment when Captain Sensible appeared to be far from sensible. And whose idea was the White Rabbit?
At number 1, it's Sensible's surreal moment.
Is Mr. Crane going to join me in the warehouse?
Yes, I think it's.
Is that all right?
No, it smells too much.
I think it's good.
I'm never going to.
One international star loved the show so much that on one occasion he even flew over from New York on Concorde to appear at the last moment. He made us laugh whenever he appeared, not least on this occasion.
Michael, are you around?
I had a little mishap.
Oh,
it's very nice to see you. You are looking well. Looking very well indeed.
I'm delighted now to welcome Michael Crawford via satellite all the way from Sydney. Good morning.
Good morning, Noel.
Thank you for interrupting your holiday for this. And you've got some great memories of Swap Shop, I believe.
I do. I mean, that was the time that joke was meant to be just before Barnum started in London. And I'd just been over to the Big Apple Circus School and been training with all these young geniuses and came back with every bone in my body broken. But Swap Shop was so useful to put forward at these shows. We had kids come for 4 years to see Barnum, and so it was invaluable to us.
One of your most popular appearances was when you flew over for a wonderful version of Music of the Night from Phantom of the Opera. Now, I want your thoughts on this, but I'm just going to refresh your memory by showing you a little bit of a clip.
Away from the garish light of day, turn your thoughts away.
It was absolutely sensational in the truest sense of the word. What do you remember of that?
I just remember the same feeling that it gave me then, that it brings tears to your eyes, and the extraordinary effort and passion and love that went into their performance. Damien and Helen.
Yeah.
It was. They must have practiced for weeks and weeks and weeks, and it was blessed.
It was a very powerful televisual moment, and I remember a lot of people contacting us and saying that they'd been inspired by it, and we've actually got a message from Damien Ward for you. Have a look at this.
Slowly, gently, night unfurls its splendor.
Hi, Mike, will remember me. Me and my partner, Helen, dance for you on going live. I hope you enjoyed it.
Turn your face away from the garish light of day.
My partner, Helen, still loves dancing. We want to see if I keep her coming to see us.
And listen to the music of the night.
I'm Damien's mum, and I'd just like to say what a happy day that was. And what was so wonderful was that they were in a normal situation, being accepted like everyone else. I'm 80 now, and that is the happiest day of my life.
I think that's one to be proud of, isn't it? You really made something special happen then.
Oh, boy, oh, boy, oh, boy. It makes you feel very, very, very humble that something meant so much to that mother and to Damien, and I send my love to them both, and very, very special. Oh, I'm so glad this happened.
Thank you very much for joining us. Go back to your holiday and please enjoy it. And on behalf of everyone associated with Swap Shop, thank you for the major contribution you made on so many occasions.
Thank you, Noel, and to all the team. Thank you very much, and thanks for giving me the opportunity to say thank you all this way away in Australia.
Enjoy your holiday.
Bless
Ladies
you.
And gentlemen,
thank you.
Michael Crawford.
So now we find ourselves back in 1987. At Wimbledon, Australia found a new hero in the shape of one Pat Cash. In cinemas, and please be calm now, ladies, a certain Patrick Swayze was sending pulses racing in Dirty Dancing. And now the bit I've been dreading, one word burst onto the music scene, and go with me on this one, a seed! Whatever that means. And Saturday mornings were all set to go live.
Earlier on today, apparently, a woman rang the BBC and said she heard that there was a hurricane on the way. Well, if you're watching, don't worry, there isn't.
In 1987, Michael Fish got it wrong and hurricane winds battered Britain. Children watched spellbound as Richard Branson splashed down. Well, I guess it would be nice. Things stayed the same for Mrs. Thatcher at number 10, but Saturday mornings were changing.
I'm going to stop saying thank you now, as I'm going to burst into tears.
After five incredible years, Saturday Superstore shut its doors and a new show filled the slot.
Studio 7, Television Centre. Hi! Going live!
Philip Schofield and Gordon the Gopher were promoted from the broom cupboard and joined Sarah Green for Going Live.
Very much indeed.
Come on. The show appealed to the whole family and upped the tempo to keep them glued for 3 hours. Trevor and Simon injected comedy. Double Dare provided the thrills. And in a new feature, children's problems were tackled live on air.
Lots and lots of areas of subject, from, you know, being too fat, too thin, right up to things like death and sadness.
The team thrived in this new environment, and like Swap Shop, the show ran for 6 years.
Well, I'm delighted to say we've been joined by the biggest star of Going Live, Gordon the Gopher. Hello, Gordon. Small in stature, big on talent. How are you?
What's he you saying, John? From the broom cupboard, didn't you?
He's saying that dog's not around, is it?
Well, Going Live was a hugely popular show with Philip Schofield, Sarah Green, Trevor and Simon, and not forgetting, of course, you, Gordon, who all successfully carried on the tradition of must-see Saturday morning telly.
This is the BBC television service.
Going Live exploded onto our screens, jam-packed with colour and energy.
We have a show for you this morning.
The team was joined by a furry frontman, Gordon the Gopher.
Get off me! He's got my finger!
Just stealing this now, aren't you? Nobody's listening to a word I'm saying. There's no need for that abuse.
To feed the frog, you catch those flies, because prize and points and points and prize. I've never said it as quickly as that, because we must get on with the game. Welcome to Mega Shot.
Phones were now used to play computer games.
3, 2, 1, go.
Left. Fire. Left go.
You got 9 points on Mega Shot!
And spring surprises.
Now it's time for Live Line.
And in the best traditions of Swap Shop, celebrities joined in the fun.
I'm a huge fan of yours.
Really?
Yes.
I'm sorry, I don't listen to pop music. Who is she?
Thank you.
I just want to mention something. Do you notice a similarity here? you know, what do you think? Profiles. Yeah.
I never said a word.
Yeah, but I can see you.
Just 1 second, I can't let this moment go. Nigel, come on. There he is. Can't put a good man down. Fantastic.
Hello. All right. Have you seen your old chums, Philip and Sarah, lately? Well, only last week. What were you up to? Really?
Look, it's Judy. Out of, what's it?
Judy. Judy.
No, Richard and Judy. Hello, madam.
Hi, guys. Hi.
Going up?
Yeah.
Yeah, so give us our regards to Richard, won't you? Oh, here he is, Richard.
Nice to see you.
Oh, hi.
Just
It's not Richard and Judy. It's old Sconesbury, isn't it? Philip Sconesbury.
And Graham Greene.
Graham Greene, Going Live.
Going Live, that's it.
Oh, see,
it.
Good, clean family entertainment.
Oh, suitable for everyone.
Yeah.
We're going where the sea is blue.
Do I have to do this?
Great stuff.
Sorry to interrupt. That was a good one.
Yeah, yeah.
But what about this one?
No!
gotta be!
Hold up, listen tight. Well done.
It is good to be back down here, but that was just incredible.
That was a good one, wasn't it? Mm-hmm. And let me point out as well, I was, in fact, a world record holder.
It's a big wave here. There's the first marker.
The results for Philip Schofield, average 42.98, a new world and national record.
Oh, he's a clever boy. That's impressive.
You see, guys, it was always Christmas time. That's when the best moments happened. Yeah. All that dressing up, play acting. Mm. You remember?
I do. I wonder whether you'd like to dance.
Yeah, I would.
Yeah,
wasn't that great?
Yes.
Yeah? And it wasn't a stunt double, was it?
People said it was.
No. Swat. And the other moments I loved always happen around the piano. George Shulte, Dudley Moore.
Leaving you, Skidlina, goodbye. Wish fuck, by fart, stutter, fart, water. Goodbye, goodbye. Leaving you, Skidlina, goodbye. Wish fuck, goodbye.
Very professional, that.
Very professional.
Yeah, yeah. Mm.
No, no, they never called us that, did they?
No.
Bodie and Doyle.
Richard and Judy would do better.
I still reckon we've aged the best out of all of them.
You're right. Good night, Gordon.
Good night, Gordon.
We swing our pants forever and a day.
We had nice dress.
Hi, guys.
Hi.
Can't you swing any faster?
I'll try, but I'm riddled with arthritis. La 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 la
la la la la la. Now, I'm delighted to say we're joined by Arlene Phillips, who, of course, is one of those very tough judges on Strictly Come Dancing, if not the toughest. But back in the 80s, you were very, very tough, putting the team through a big workout.
I did, indeed,
on Saturday Superstore. Here we got the clip.
And stretch.
Well, that's ruined your credibility.
It's all over now with my hair.
Well, you sorted John and Maggie out then.
I sorted everybody out that came in my path. Nothing's changed.
Anything you want to say?
Yeah, we're still recovering.
So, were they happy days for you, those Saturday shows?
Oh, yeah. I loved doing Saturday morning television. I loved it. And I was asked on whether it was with Hot Gossip or because I did an exercise video. There was always something, and I loved it. It was always crazy and funny. You never knew what you were going to do. Mm-hmm. You just went on, and that was it. No rehearsal.
Great fun. Yeah. Great fun. We're asking all our star guests to produce a swap. Keith is ready to try and transact the swap.
Right.
What have you brought, Arlene?
Well, I brought a paddle signed by the judges so you can all play. and a signed photograph framed of the miserable judges. Bruce and Tess wishing happy anniversary to 30 years of Swap Shop. And a very, very covetable, very rare Strictly Come Dancing T-shirt. And the Strictly Come Dancing book. Could you want any more than that?
Well, that's a proper swap package.
That's a real swap.
Yeah, I think the audience were actually hoping for something from Come Dancing, but there you go, not to worry. OK, any offers for it? We've got Mousetrap, we've got a kangaroo, we've got an XXX shirt, Swap Shop, a DVD player, loads of stuff. Arlene, you can see it for yourself.
Smurf is shouting louder, so it has to be Smurf.
Where's the Smurf?
There's
Where?
Smurf.
Where? Oh, right the way down here. Hang on, let me get through there. Lovely. Great. Oh, don't do that. Grown-up man like yourself. Good heavens. OK. You've got all that stuff from Arlene's stuff there. And you've got a Smurf catch. Hey!
Arlene Phillips.
ladies and gentlemen.
Thank you.
Cheers. Well, as we discovered after Lenny Henry's recommendation, it didn't take long for the producers to put comedy at the heart of going live. Two likely lads were soon cast in the shape of Trevor and Simon, and a whole new range of catchphrases were about to hit the playground.
Reasons to be cheerful, part three.
One, two, three. Hello. Hello, everybody in TV land.
Oh, hello, miss.
Hello. Hello.
What can we do for you, then?
I have my ticket, but I have my sweatshirt, please.
It's come out like this. Sorry.
It's so funny! Perfect! So funny! I love this country! I just can't get enough of it! I love it!
Oh, what do all these do now? Oh, we don't do duvets!
We don't do duvets!
Actually, they don't do duvets.
They don't do duvets? I don't believe it!
Wait a minute, stop!
What's the matter? Have you forgotten your pants?
No, but we've forgotten our special guest for this morning.
Today we're joined by one of the Pogues.
No, Kylie.
Sorry?
Kylie.
Oh, yes, Kylie from the Pogues.
Oh, Kylie Minogue. Minogue.
Well, blow it then.
What?
Your nose.
No, Kylie Minogue. Neighbours.
What, she just moved in or what?
Hang on a minute, if you're Jason Orange then, are you Howard Grape and Mark Apple?
Yeah.
Oh. Ah. Oh yeah, you are sponsor, Mr. Ribbit.
Have you ever stroked a weasel? Chair, come on in. Take a bottle. There you go. Make yourself comfortable.
Welcome aboard.
Now, take
hey, me hearties.
Hi.
Welcome to Let's Go Bonkers, the part of the show where everyone goes.
Oh. And why do we want to go bonkers?
Just for
you! Indeed, because we all like a bit of a laugh.
Large fields of
and
mud.
And swampy areas.
Swamps of bogs.
Well, you had this wonderful array of stars who appeared with you. Did any of them object to the way which you treated them?
Well, thankfully, no. I mean, we had so many big stars who said they're, you know, just happy to do it. I mean, we had, like, Elvis, John F. Kennedy.
No, you're amazing.
And they all said yes.
You're getting carried away. I don't think we did have them. The only people I can remember, actually, who did object were Bross.
That's true, Bross. Yeah.
And I don't know, they wouldn't do a sketch with others. I think they were threatened by our good looks. I don't know.
But I've just been reminded of so much. I genuinely had forgotten so many things. I didn't remember that I'd been kissed by Catherine Zeta-Jones.
What kind of man forgets that?
I know.
That's crazy.
You know, because obviously then I was a bit young for her, but now I might stand a chance, you know. So, you know, it's looking
I enjoyed seeing that bit with Cher because it reminded me. And this bit, sadly, didn't go out because it was right at the end of the show. She'd done the press conference or hot seat at the end of the show. And I came on and waltzed around with her to Crazy by Patsy Cline. But it was just after she'd had, supposedly, plastic surgery to remove ribs. And I remember putting my arm around her and running my fingers up and down her ribs and counting them. She was so thin. I don't know if there was one missing or not. I just remember sort of going like that and there was a nice tune made.
And who else?
It's true.
Who else did you enjoy fondly?
Oh, no, I don't think we fondled. We didn't fondle anybody. We had a Dame, Judi Dench, we had as a guest. Yeah. And we were really nervous about meeting her, but we thought, well, she's a fine actress. She turned up, she was really nervous as well, so we were all just very nervous. The only reason she did it, she said, was because her child said it was cool.
We had Paul McCartney coming on once, and I remember sort of even going, oh, can you do an autograph for our kids? And we were going like, wow, it's Paul McCartney. And I remember sort of doing this autograph for this little girl, who I guess now is Stella McCartney.
Did you ever go too far, would you say?
Well, occasionally, only because it was live. I mean, I can't say, you know, we're not that proud of all the innuendo, but occasionally,
you are.
You know, because we did
dirty mouth
comedy.
Man.
No.
We never did clever comedy.
There was one moment which, unfortunately, I was doing an impression of Jimmy Hill, the football expert, and I was given a kind of prosthetic chin that was a very kind of long, pink thing, and it was obscene, frankly. And and I just said, you know, to have a chin like this, you've got to be in a special club. It's members only. And
that got caused a bit of
but
a stir.
But
the things
there,
that caused the fuss were crazy things. I mean, we did the singing corner actually did a single with Donovan, and they showed the video of that. And someone wrote in a letter of complaint that actually said they were a big fan of Donovan, and they were disgusted that on children's TV, Donovan was seen cavorting with two homosexuals.
Of course,
I don't know if it meant us or the characters or what.
I mean, we've given that up now, obviously. But, yeah.
OK, well, I'm very pleased. What? Come on, we move on. Would you please show your appreciation for these two, please?
Well, a lot of star names thoroughly enjoyed the Saturday morning TV of their youth. Chris Moyles.
Hello.
Welcome, welcome.
Hello, Noel.
How are you?
I'm very excited to be on Swap Shop.
I'm excited to have you here.
I'm so excited. And you and I have never met.
Oh.
And I'm meeting you on Swap Shop. My head's all over the place. I don't know what year it is. I don't know what's going on.
It's 1976.
Wow.
How old were you?
Oh, I'm not even born, because I'm only about 23. But
Have a look at this picture that we got. There's Chris with his mum. So tell me about your memories of Saturday morning television.
I remember all of it. I remember Swap Shop really clearly. I'm 32, but I remember Swap Shop really clearly, and I remember the phone number, because it was having to phone that there London, and mum and dad weren't happy about it. But it didn't really matter, because you never got through.
And the number was?
01818055.
And don't forget the 01 if you're outside London.
That's right, which I was in Leeds. Leeds is always outside London. And I remember waiting to see if Keith Chegwin ever came to Leeds, and I swear this is absolutely true. The one day I was sick in bed, he turned up in Leeds. I was furious.
Last year on the Swappy, have you brought a swap?
Of course I have. Of course I've brought a swap. I've brought Scale Xtrix. Oh, they're starting already.
And here he is. Keith, meet Chris. Chris, meet Keith.
Chris, do me a favour. Look, we didn't meet in Leeds, did we? We met before, but come and join me now. Come
can
on,
I?
Come over here.
Can I bring
you? Bring the
right,
Scale Xtrix with you. OK. We're looking for something for Chris Moyles' Scale Xtrix. Do we have any offers? Look, Chris, it's all there for you. What would you like? You've got annuals, Blue Peter annuals, you've got a kangaroo, mousetrap, family addicts there. You've got the Checkers Choice album, no.
I've got to admit, there's a signed picture of Noel behind the Swap Shop desk.
And a sticker.
And a sticker.
Come here.
Which I must admit, is getting me quite excited.
Fantastic. Let me come through there. What's your name?
Mark.
Mark, OK. Are you happy to let them go?
Very, very happy.
I've got to...
We've got
a picture of Noel Edmonds, we've got the Swap Shop sticker. Oh, my gosh, you've got a picture of the team and Posh Paws as well. Chris Moyles, thank you very much.
Thank you.
Whee!
Thanks, Chris. Thank you very much. That was
incredible. Oh, slippery doo-dah, slippery my, oh, my, what a slippery
Oh, doggy! Oh, I think that dog's getting worse. Oh, he nearly nipped my Jennifer Junipers.
Oh. Donnie's hungry, that's all. He hasn't had anything to eat since 1994.
Well, nor have we. The last thing I ate were those peanuts I found in a customer's trousers.
Are you sure they were peanuts?
Well, I don't know. They tasted very salty.
Cashews.
Bless you.
Hey, I found some mints in that old lady's dressing gown this morning.
Oh, lovely. I'll make a nice cottage pie.
No, not steak mints. Polo mints.
I don't know how to make a polo pie. Oh, Dougie, we're going to have to get a customer soon, otherwise we're going to starve.
Oh, Don, don't worry. Cool down, cool down. Hey, I think we've got a customer. Oh, at last!
No, Dougie, no. I don't think that's a customer, Dougie. I think it's some old down and out.
Are you open?
Open? Oh, we're open, yeah. Don's very open.
Yeah, get lost, you stinking old tramp. You need a shave, sunshine.
See what I mean?
I meant, is the shop open?
Not to the likes of you, and you're not sleeping in our doorway either.
No, I'm not homeless. In fact, I think you'll find I've got quite an important job.
Oh, yes. Yeah. What's that, then? Looking in bins? No.
I think you'll find, actually, I'm Britain's number one radio host.
Oh, it's Jonathan Ross. Oh.
Jonathan Ross.
Oh. It's not Jonathan Ross, it's Chris Moyles.
Oh.
I'm the saviour of Radio 1.
Oh, no, I'm sorry, I don't listen to Radio 1.
No, me neither. Well, I can't. I haven't got an ASBO. Or a hoodie.
I've had enough of this. If you could just clean that, I'll pick it up tomorrow.
Oh, oh. What is it, you... Oh, is it your stinking old sleeping bag?
No. It's a duvet.
You shouldn't have said, Don, keep cool. Calm down, Don. No, you shouldn't have said that. No,
we don't do duvets!
We don't do duvets.
We don't do duvets.
We don't do duvets.
We don't do duvets.
Don, behave yourself. Look. Don.
Some of the old regular customers are back. This is the most customers we've had in a decade. Can I help you?
Actually, well, you can serve this tramp first. That'd be fine. No rush.
I'm not a tramp. I'm Chris Moyles, the saviour of Radio 1.
Oh. Blimey, you've let yourself go, haven't you? Emma, look, it's Chris Moyles from Radio 1.
I don't listen to Radio 1. I haven't got an ASBO.
These two won't do my duvet.
Oh, yeah, that's... They don't do duvets.
Oi, 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 sunshine, that's my catchphrase. You stick to Ed the Duck. Now, listen, mate, we don't do duvets.
We don't do duvets.
Well, look, if you could do it for me, I could give you a signed copy of my autobiography, The Gospel According to Chris Moyles, which is out now in all good bookshops and quite bad chemists.
Let's have a look, then.
Yeah.
Just as I thought. Full of rudery and filth. Yeah, I think this book could do with a good clean.
Whoa. Bloody hell, give me that back! That's my book, for God's sake.
Hey, watch your language. You could do with a good clean as well. Get in the dry cleaning machine. Go on, give him a good clean. Go on, Queenie. Whiz it round. Go on, round. Go on, Milesy. Get in.
Oh, dear. Oh, John, what have you done? It looks like we're going to go hungry again. Unless you've got anything you want dry cleaning.
Well, I have, actually. We brought in some items a little while ago. I think, actually, we brought them in, 1994?
Yeah, about 94.
Not duvets.
No, not duvets. Not duvets. It was a mini skirt and a check shirt.
Oh, yes, Andy, you always look good in a mini skirt.
No, the shirt was mine.
Oh, right.
The skirt was hers.
Well, have you got the ticket?
Oh, yes, yeah, hang on a sec.
Oh!
Yeah. Oh, wait, watch out, everybody! Andy Peters is opening his wallet! Oh, watch out for the moths!
Yeah. No, that's not so untrue, because I'm actually quite generous. It's you two that made me look mean. You just made that up.
It's like the state opening of Parliament.
Okay, so is that it? Yeah, this is the ticket, I'm afraid. And it's the same one. We've had it for about 12 years.
Is that all right? Yes. They'll be ready next Tuesday. There you are.
Next Tuesday?
Yes, you heard the man. See you next Tuesday.
Yeah, go on.
Go on.
Okay, go.
Go on.
Whoosh. I tell you, I'm glad they've gone. I think I prefer it without any customers.
Me too.
Hey, I think Queenie's finished her cycle. You know, that Chris Moyles will have cleaned up nicely now.
Yeah, let's see how he's doing then. Come on out, Moyles. Let's see how you've scrubbed up.
Hello.
Oh, John. Oh, John. God, he really has cleaned up a treat, hasn't he?
He's turned into a lovely lady.
Yeah.
Do you mind? I've only come here to plug my book.
No, not another one. Listen, you get off. Get back to Radio 1 and all your hooligan mates.
Go Radio on, 1, up. I've never been so insulted in my life. I present Holiday. Goodbye.
Holiday. Goodbye. Go off on your holiday. Holiday, I recognise that face.
Yes, yeah. Now I come to think of it. The long hair, the lovely tan. Yeah. It was Judith Chalmers.
Judith Chalmers.
Hey, you shut it!
But now it's 1993, and according to Muller and Scuddy, the truth is out there. On the big screen, Mr. Spielberg was about to convince cinema audiences all over the world that dinosaurs still existed. But we knew that. Take That came close to the Beatles' phenomenal popularity with three number ones. The new body trend was body piercing, while the in toy was a Mr. Blobby. And probably the least said about that, the better. But on Saturday mornings, the going was gone, but the live was now kicking.
In 1993, Britain's biggest horse race, the Grand National, stumbled at the starting gate. Take That ruled the charts, and the Queen broke with tradition by allowing the public into her London pad. But one Saturday morning tradition remained the same.
Bye-bye.
Going Live came to an end. Live and Kicking was launched.
You're watching BBC One for the very first edition of Live and Kicking!
Room cupboard veteran Andi Peters joined Going Live cook Emma Forbes and actor John Barrowman to present the new show.
Oh, that's a good idea.
In a world where kids had more on offer, Live and Kicking had to work hard to get noticed. By picking up the pace, it squeezed more entertainment into 3 hours than ever before. With fantastic guests and Run the Risk, it proved an award-winning formula and continued the tradition of turning its presenters into stars.
So how do you think your show moved on from its predecessors?
Oh, it was a tough act to follow Philip and Sarah because they were brilliant. But we just kind of, I guess, moved the pace up, really.
Yeah, I think we became even faster. And it was just the start of, you know, people watching using the internet, being very aware of faxing and all that sort of stuff. So we sort of introduced all those
features
into the
show. It got even more interactive, I think. Yeah. That was what happened.
And there was a fantastic chemistry between you two.
There was. There still is, luckily.
Yeah,
thank
the Lord. It's funny because we didn't ever audition to do the show together.
No.
I mean, we literally, the first time we met was sort of the week we were going to do the first Saturday. Mm. And
it kind of grew. It sort of just, I don't know, it just sort of happened. We didn't try very, you can't really try with chemistry. It just sort of evolved.
Well, it was good. I mean, it was great television. Let's look at some of the highlights and Mitch will take us through it.
Oh,
ooh, wow!
Live and Kicking was the fourth generation of the show to fill Saturday mornings with quick-fire entertainment.
Good morning!
The programme had a guest list that read like a showbiz who's who.
What's the first instrument you ever played and how old were you?
I used to play on the linoleum.
What's the linoleum? Can you explain it?
That was a joke.
Oh.
How do you manage to stay young and attractive?
That's not your question.
Thank you very much for being in the hot seat today. I hope you'll come back again.
Thank you.
It offered an amazing variety of features.
Hello, welcome to Run the Risk.
I'm Bob.
And I'm Bess.
And he's Baz.
And he's Bob.
With Andi and Emma at the heart of the show.
I hope you're enjoying the show at home because we're having such fun today and I hope it's coming through to the television. It's great.
And who could forget their last show together when Emma surprised Andi with a time machine and little help from her mum.
Good evening, the headlines.
That is the last show.
Hey!
Oh!
Hey!
Oh.
Work?
What will you miss most about Live and Kicking?
Emma.
Oh! I'll see you in September.
Bye-bye.
Watch that without crying a little bit. How sad is that?
I understand. Yeah. He is a man of routine. Is that true?
Oh, completely. I mean, part of our chemistry was based on the fact that Andi, it was kind of done in a... I was a very good team to him. He was completely a man of routine. He had to have toast and Marmite, but only in the first cartoon. Couldn't eat the toast and Marmite pre the cartoon. On a Friday, I used to leave rehearsals from here, and I used to have to rush to get to buy Madeira cake because he couldn't get through a show without Madeira cake slices that I'd hand sliced alone behind the scenes like this, and he'd have the Madeira cake, and I used to sometimes I'd be breaking into a sweat to get things, and then at 10 o'clock there'd be a thing saying let's blend our wardrobes.
Hang on.
Oh,
Madeira cake.
How happy are you?
say, knowing Madeira cake as I know Madeira cake, that is the one provided and baked by Uncle Mark and Spencer. That is marvellous.
Go on, have a slice.
It had to be that one. It had to be that. It couldn't be pre-sliced. It had to be the whole thing. Happy?
It's a nice
happy boy now.
Wicked, thank you.
All right, it's great to see you both.
Well, it's
and
a
now
to be here.
We've got another round of our quiz.
Are you ready for this?
We're ready.
Well, in the first series of Live and Kicking, there was another presenter. Have a look.
Hi, Andy. Hi, Emma. Unfortunately, Emma, this one is for you. I want you to cast your mind back to a day when Martin Bell, Britain's top downhill skier, was sitting on the hot seat, and a young girl rang in and had a rather unusual request. Do you, Emma Forbes, remember what that request was?
Well, that was John Barrowman.
Yeah, that was John Barrowman. Only John Barrowman would ask a question like that. I know exactly what that was.
Come on, come on, what was it?
A child rang in and said, can I see your donga? I think it was the word donga they used, wasn't it? Mm-hmm. It was a donga, and there was a brief pause, and again, luckily, Chris in my ear went, move on. And John would remember that. Isn't that the right answer?
Let's see.
Hi, who's that?
It's Caroline.
Hi, Caroline, you're through to Martin.
Hi. You were talking to Andi Peters earlier.
I certainly was.
Me and the girls won't mind a look at your donga.
Have you got another question? Have you got another one, a proper one for Saturday morning?
I beg your pardon.
Andi Peters.
Yeah. Okay, this one's for you, Andy. Take a look at the clip and tell me who is behind the curtain.
Who were those people? Who were those people? Who were those people?
Yes, I don't. Two.
Two. Could have been out of a.
I'm trying to do a boy band, but there wasn't.
Oh, I'll tell you what, have another piece of cake. Here's the answer.
Hey!
This is for both of you.
Okay.
This is a real favourite for many people. Cast your eyes over this.
Could we open my window, please? Daryl and Sam, good morning. Who do you do good impressions of?
No one.
Oh, don't give me that, Daryl. Oh, it's all going so well already. If we open our video window now, we will see that there they are.
You won the pools, didn't you get your money? Yeah. Who handed it over? That bloke you ate off the telly. Bobby Damro? No. Ready Start? No. Terry Hogan? No. Who was it then? This could go on all day. Andy Peters.
Oi! Oi!
Oi! He's not on the telly very much. But you ate him, didn't you? And so do I.
I think we'd all agree, fantastically talented boys called Daryl and Sam. Yeah. Not surprisingly, yeah. They went on to appear on the show again. But just how memorable are they 13 years on? We have a lineup.
Oh no!
Three pairs. And which pair do you think were on Famous for 5 minutes?
So two of these people are Daryl and Sam?
Yeah.
Oh my. I think it's.
These two.
I think it's those two. You know why? Because
no, it's him on the left. Look at that. Look at that.
I think it's those two.
Are we going for these two?
Yeah.
Okay, so these two on the right.
Yeah, I think they're Daryl and Sam.
Okay, will the real Daryl and Sam please step? There we go.
Yeah! Yeah.
Thank you guys very much indeed, and thank you, Andy and Emma. Thank you very much. Big names from entertainment to the top pop stars that appeared through the years. But Saturday mornings just wouldn't have been the same without our four-legged friends.
Come on!
Hello.
Meet Bert. Isn't Bert nice?
There's little wet paws all over your letters now.
Oh, no! Oh, Volvo!
This is the front doors, this is the back end. That belongs to it.
If you're a connoisseur of art, we've actually got
Pablo.
All right, all right. There's a
here we go.
Well, thank you, Dave. Thank you to all our friendly contributors, and even Pablo the Duck is here. Pablo, your painting skills have improved a bit. Well, there have been some very special and talented ladies gracing Saturday mornings over the last 30 years, none more so than my next guest from the Saturday show. Will you please welcome Fern Cotton? When you were a little girl, what did you watch on Saturday mornings?
Well, unfortunately, I wasn't born when Swap Shop was on.
anyway, that's all we've got time for, so...
Sorry, Noel, but I'm sure it was...
No, go for the jugular.
But no, I loved Live and Kicking with Zoe and Jamie. They were my absolute heroes. And I haven't really told many people this, but when I was about 14, I was actually in the audience for one of the shows, and I just absolutely loved it. And I got to meet Zoe and Jamie, and literally from that point on, I thought, that's what I want to do. That's what spurred it all on, really, for me.
And can you sum up the emotion of what it was like when you got that first job?
Oh, it was absolutely unbelievable. A, I got out of school, which was genius. and, you know, we just got bands on every week that I loved watching anyway, and it was just, you know, the funnest job I could have as a kid ever, and I still love it now so much.
What about its significance in terms of developing your career?
Well, I don't think you can possibly do a more difficult show. I mean, Saturday morning TV, as you know, you've got kids in the studio, possibly animals at times, pop stars, they can be a bit tricky. And, you know, it's all combined in a live show where you just don't know what's going to happen. So I learned everything about presenting, doing Saturday morning TV.
Well, we've obviously all been bathing in nostalgia. What do those days mean to you?
You know, every Saturday I religiously get up in the morning to watch Live and Kicking and going live as well. And, you know, we'd want to see all the cartoons and the bands on the show, and that basically shaped our whole weekend as kids. And, you know, watching bits of it back is just like, oh, it's great to watch back. It just brings back such great memories. Mm. Lovely.
Well, I realise you don't have the 30 years experience that we do.
Not quite.
So we put it on auto cue for you.
Thank
you. Would you like to read the next link, Fern?
I can do that for you, Noel. Tonight we've all travelled back and relived our childhoods through the clips and memories of Saturday mornings from Swap Shop right through to Live and Kicking. And as Noel just said, we've now reached the final chapter, so let's bring you bang up to date.
Zoe Ball.
Yes.
Jamie Peters.
Hello.
This is
Shamrock.
Yes.
First people to do this.
Are you telling me there were other shows before us?
No, no, 30 years ago we were still stars in the sky.
It all started with Swap Shop.
Yeah, with Noel, Maggie, Keith and John. Have a cracking 30th, guys.
And have a really good night.
Bye.
Well, we all... The four of us really hope you've enjoyed this special edition of Swap Shop when, as you can see by our clock, time stood still. It's still 9:30. And as you saw earlier in the show, Tom Baker was the very first guest on Swap Shop, so we thought it was only fitting that we'd leave him with the final word.
So it really all started with Swap Shop nearly 30 years ago. And whether you swapped or sang or danced or questioned or simply tuned in just to watch, they were happy days. Yes. Goodbye. No, no, not goodbye. Happy days! Yes!
Those were the days of our lives. The bad things in life were so few. I look
I think it should be us applauding you because, of course, Swap Shop and all of the Saturday morning children's shows on BBC television wouldn't have been successful without you. But Swap Shop really is closing for business once and for all. Goodbye.